شکریہ اے حافظ و اس کا رہو کرتے ادا، حفظ قرآن کے لیے اللہ نے تم کو چنا۔ شکریہ اے حافظ و اس کا۔
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ahlan wa sahlan wa marhaban bikum. Welcome to another edition of Pearls from the Quran. Today we take a look at the 8th juz of the Quran al-Kareem. I want to take a look at two verses tonight. The first is the concluding verse of Surah Al-Anfal, verse 165. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala talks about why all human beings are not granted in equal measure. Whether it's wealth, whether it's profile, whether it's knowledge, different people receive in different quantities and different qualities as well. Allah تبارك وتعالى says, وَهُوَ الَّذِي جَعَلَكُمْ خَلَائِفَ الْأَرْضِ وَرَفَعَ بَعْضَكُمْ فَوْقَ بَعْضٍ دَرَجَاتٍ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ فِي مَا آتَاكُمْ. It is, Allah is the one who has placed you as viceroys, as deputies upon the earth. So all of you are the deputies of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala upon the earth. But Allah has elevated some of you above others in rank so as to test you in what He has given you. So the ulama have written, the mufassirin have explained that Allah has not created everyone equal in terms of rank. Yes, in terms of them being human, in terms of them being entitled to certain basic rights, in terms of them having equal opportunity to please Allah and to attain Jannah, that in that regard, everyone is equal. But in terms of rank, Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has granted someone more and others less. Some are wealthy, others are poor, some are weak, others are strong, some are leaders, others are followers. And these differences are there for a variety of reasons, and there are a variety of wisdoms. Some of them, one is that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala can then test them. The wealthy are tested to see if they utilize their wealth correctly. The poor are tested to see if they bear that difficulty with patience. The leaders are tested to see if they are kind and compassionate to their followers. The followers are tested to see if they are obedient to their rulers. Another reason why there is difference in rank in terms of humans is that those who have been granted a little more can then show gratitude to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala when they see those who have been granted a little less in whichever category it may be. That's why Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said that when any one of you sees someone who is superior to him in wealth or in beauty, then he should look at someone less fortunate to him so that he can be grateful to Allah. And actually Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us that when it comes to spiritual things, always keep your gaze focused on those who are doing more. If you're performing your 5 daily namazes, then don't say, ah, look at that man, he doesn't read namaz, because then you're going to become lazy. Rather say, hey, look at that man, he's performing tahajjud, and he's performing ishraq and chast. He performs his salah with so much of humility, and he takes his time in performing his salah. So always look at those who are higher than you when it comes to spiritual matters, so that you can aspire to do more. But when it comes to material matters, look at those who have less, so that greed does not develop within you, and so that you can be content. Otherwise, you'll always be chasing. There's always someone who has more than you. That's why you'll be number 2 on the Forbes list, but you want to be number 1. The man is a billionaire, but he works 18 hours a day because he wants that additional billion. Even if he's number 1 on the Forbes list, he's looking over his shoulder. He wants to remain number 1. So in one hadith, it is mentioned that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam has said that Allah will record as grateful a man who has two qualities. A person who has two qualities, Allah will record that person as being grateful and patient. And what are those two qualities? The first, with regards to deen, he looks at those who are doing more than him, those who excel him. And with regards to matters of this world, he looks at those who are less fortunate than him, and he shows gratitude to Allah. And the person who is the opposite, then naturally that person will not be regarded as patient, nor will that person be regarded as grateful in the court of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. The second verse which I want to discuss for tonight is verse 55 of Surah Al-A'raf. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala talks about the etiquettes of making dua. And this month of Ramadan is the month of dua. Du'as are readily accepted by Allah. Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, Udu'u rabbakum tadarru'a wa khufya. Call out unto your Rabb, call out unto your sustainer, unto Allah, in humility and silence. Two things are mentioned here, humility and silence. Now the scholars have written, naturally, you are begging. You are the one who's totally dependent. Allah is the one who is totally independent. When you're begging before Allah, you need to show humility. That's why there are etiquettes of dua. You cannot be this way, that way. You're making dua, you're looking into the heavens, you're relaxing this way, that way. As if you're nonchalant, indifferent. Yeah, if you give me, it's okay. If you don't give me, it's okay. Look at one human when they ask another human. Both of them are humans. Both of them are humans. But when one human asks another human, you present yourself in such a way where you show that, you know what, I have relevant respect for you because I'm asking something of you. Now, this is Allah, Rabbul Alameen, the source of everything. Allah says, when you call out unto Allah, when you're supplicating to Allah, show humility before Allah. And then Allah says, وَخُفْيَا, and do it silently. Now, scholars write that whilst it's permissible to make dua loudly, it is preferred that dua should be made silently, except in justified circumstances. Justified circumstances would mean, for example, at the time of Salatul Istisqa, when you're making a collective dua, so naturally the imam is going to make the dua loudly and everyone behind him is going to say Ameen. But when you're on your own, it's preferred that you make dua silently because Allah can hear you. Allah is nearby. And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala does not require for you to scream at him. It is mentioned in one hadith that Sahaba asked, Ya Rasulullah, where is Allah? Is he nearby? Is he close by? So that how do we call out to him? And Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala responded by saying, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ. When my bondsman supplicates to me, then I am close to him. In another hadith, narration of Bukhari, it is mentioned, I am as my servant expects from me. As per your expectations of me, that's how I will deal with you. And I am with you when you remember me. I am with you when you remember me. So when a person is making dua and begging of Allah, then Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala says, I am there for you and I remember you. Meaning my special attention is focused on you. Your Rabb is closer to you than your neck, than your jugular vein. So there's no need to call out to Allah loudly and to scream and shout. We must call out to Allah in a way that shows humility. And then we must cry. And if we can't cry, we must pretend to cry. Totally lowering ourselves in front of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Then scholars write, we mustn't make any request that is illegal. I mean, that's the height of disrespect. If Allah has prohibited something, you ask Allah for that. Secondly, we mustn't go into specifics because that is being insulting to Allah. One sahabi heard his son making dua, that Allah give me a palace in Jannah, but it must be a white palace and it must be on the right hand side. So this man said, ask Allah for entry into Jannah and protection from Jahannam. That's enough. Do not now become excessive and too elaborative in your dua. Yes, you can ask Allah for the highest abode in Jannah, but don't say now it must be a white palace in Jannah, oh Allah, and it must be in this corner, and it must have this angle, and it must have that shape, because that is now being insulting to Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Allah will grieve you that which is even beyond your imagination. So we must remain within the limits of the Sharia when we make dua. The problem with us is we don't make dua with conviction. Allah says, call out unto me and I'm there to respond to you. And follow those etiquettes. When you follow those etiquettes, it increases the likelihood of the dua being accepted. May Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala grant us the understanding. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Abu ammi ko khuda wa taj kal pehnaayega jiske aage चांद सूरज को ग्रहण लग जाएगा शर्त बस ये है ना हो बोलो अमल में फासला हिफ्ज़ कुरान के लिए